guys, hope you're all doing well. I'm Shruti, a Y16 student at the Department of Biological Sciences and Bioengineering. I'm currently enrolled in the dual degree program of the department, so I'll be around for another year or so at the least. This would be a very academia-specific discussion, mostly because that's all I know of, but I try my best to answer some of the questions that are not so academia-specific, based on my friends' experiences, or maybe I can just guide you to people who might know better on the subject if you wish to know more. So I'll just quickly get to where I interned last summer. Last year, I interned at Dr. J. Shenduri's lab, Department of Genome Sciences, University of Washington, which is in Seattle, United States. I would like to point out that I went there through Khurana Scholarship, which is a program funded by Department of Biotechnology, Government of India. And there'll be more details about the program as well as the lab that I interned in the description box below, which I think is a very YouTuber thing to say, but anyways. I would also like to point out that I didn't intern in the summer. I went for a 4.5 month long internship in the fall. And you know, we can discuss more on how one in the department can work out a longer internship, because going forward, that's one thing that a lot of you would have to, you know, figure out, because there'll be a lot of profs who would want you to be in the lab for a longer duration of time, mostly because it takes a little while to train you in order for you to be useful for their lab. So, you know, that could be one of the things that we discuss in detail, looking forward into the discussion. So in this section, we will be talking about how one can prepare for the internship season and be able to work at a lab of their choice in these prestigious foreign universities. So, you know, one of the things that I figured out being in academia for past couple years is that it is important that you have some decent research experience before you go out there to apply to these labs, you know, for a research internship. And so, you know, for all the Y18, Y19 peeps who might be listening to this, it's important that you go out there and choose a lab that even remotely interests you. And, you know, start somewhere. Just do well wherever you go, so that, you know, you leave a lab with a good recommendation from the person you've been working with. And, you know, just feel free to switch fields, because the earlier you start, more time you have to be able to explore different fields and figure out what is it that actually works for you. Another thing that I would like to point out is that I think we're in a very diverse and dynamic field. There are so many subfields within biology or bioengineering specifically, like systems biology, biophysics, genome sciences, where you can combine, where you can work at the intersection of biology and, you know, computer science, physics, statistics, mathematics, and, you know, be able to sort of find some, you know, a right fit for yourself. That's something that I've always liked about it, and that's something that'll always work in your favor. Now, having said that, I would just like to end this point by asking you to make a list of professors that you think will fit, or, you know, you would like to work with them. It could be within IITK or outside of it, and, you know, with the whole COVID era, it would be interesting to see, you know, how much of, you know, the computational stuff you can be a part of, which in my time I wasn't, and, you know, it's one of those good skills that you can have specifically in the time of social distancing that we are now. And, you know, before or while you're making that list, make sure that you talk to as many people as possible. Talk to students, talk to professors, you know, because it's important that you start out in the lab. Obviously the science matters, but it is very, very important, and I cannot emphasize enough, because my whole career rests on it, that find a mentor who's interested in your career, you know, who is ready for mentoring whenever you need, and, or, you know, mostly when you need, and sort of, you know, just pushes you in the right direction, because it's important that you start in the place which is very constructive for your research career. So, you know, just talk to people, talk to professors, and take feedbacks, and even if, you know, there's a professor who can't really help you, I'm sure that they'll direct you to someone who can help you. So that would be point number one, is that find a place that remotely interests you, and, you know, just start as soon as possible. Now, coming to second point, which, you know, I don't even need to say this, and it's fine that I'm saying it, is that keep your CPI good. I, you know, during the internship season when I was applying, my CPI was just, I made the cutoffs, but, you know, it's just making the cutoffs. And I know of a lot of people who have such amazing research backgrounds but weren't able to apply for all these fellowships or scholarships only because of their CPI. So, you know, I would just recommend that, you know, keep your grades high. I'm not saying, I know of people who have, you know, made it good in their research careers without, you know, a very high CPI. But, you know, it makes your journey, a high CPI makes your journey sort of easier, which would otherwise have been longer and harder. So make sure you work on that. So that would be point number two. So, you know, third point is, so this would directly, we're just not going to talk about how you should approach internship season, is that, you know, start mailing as early as possible. I know there's a timeline that's there, you know, most professors can only tell you that they can hire you post a certain, say, you know, December-ish or something, but, and specifically labs in the United States. But it's important that you at least start mailing them so that you are in touch with them, or some of them can at least know that they have to get back to you by the end of the year or something like that. And, you know, mailing is not just, is important for various reasons. One of them is obviously, you know, it increases your chances of being selected, and you can start with some of the top-notch places because you have time, and so you're not necessarily looking for backups, but you can aim high up there. But apart from that, you get a feel of the field that you want to be a part of. You read way more papers than you would otherwise, and it's just, I've heard that from so many people, and it's not just my personal experience, but you get to understand a lot about the field, and it not just helps you, it helps you a lot while you're writing, you know, your SOPs, because for Corona program that I applied to, it's, they ask for a detailed description of the field you would like to be a part of, or, you know, what you would do essentially if you get the internship. And so it's important that you have very concrete information and knowledge of the field that you're interested in. And it's, nothing is better than a good literature survey to back you up while you write all of those things. And it again helps you write more, you know, specific emails to people, and so that they know that you're actually interested in their lab. So that would be another important thing, is that obviously you'll have a list of profs, and you'll be more prepared for writing an SOP. Writing an SOP, and, you know, just it would increase your chances of getting selected. So that, and again, like, now if you do make it to some of these labs, and if you do make it to some of these programs, you know, there's a long list of programs, and I'll try to compile them, and, you know, it will be attached in the description box below, so you can go and check them out. But you know, for all these programs that I'm talking about, it's eventually, when you get selected, there'll be some sort of I wouldn't call it an interview. It's technically an interview, but it's more like you are having a discussion with this person who is willing to probably hire you in their lab, and just want to make sure how good of a fit you will be for their lab. So, you know, just make sure that in those interviews, you know why you've applied to their lab, and so it wouldn't be a lot of, like, really high-fi fancy questions and just right answer kind of questions. It would be more like they would want to test whether, what was your previous background, like, what is your background and what have you worked, or what are the fields you've been a part of, and later on they would want to know that why did you choose their lab and why are you interested. So just, you know, prepare concrete answers and don't be scared. Most people who get into these programs or get the first reply, you know, most often than not sort of get the offer. So, you know, just make sure that you stay calm. And yeah, that's sort of all I did and I would have to say about how you prepare. And so we would now get into a little bit more specific questions in the next section. So in this section, I'll be answering some of the other generic questions that have been asked. First one is, what are the skills required for the internship that I did? I think it obviously varies from one field to another, but in my case, I worked in a genome sciences lab, which is involved in sequencing technology development. So for me, they had like a project that worked that was based on answering some sort of fundamental questions. And so my background, which is mostly wet lab experiments, and up until that point, I had done about a year and a half of wet lab work. And also like a summer internship the last summer, which is Surge, which is a research program at IIT Kanpur. So you know, with the help of that, I knew most of the basic molecular biology techniques, and you know, just I had performed them. So I had hands-on experience with those things, and so I think that if you're applying to labs, it's important that you have something to show that you've had wet lab experience. Or, you know, apart from that, you can have some sort of strong computational background experience, because in the lab that I worked at, eventually something that I figured out is that I had to learn some sort of computational language or coding language to be able to analyze sequencing, you know, a lot of sequencing data that comes with a lot of single cell experiments. So I think a good knowledge of wet lab stuff, like a lot of molecular biology techniques, as well as, you know, a good knowledge of some language, maybe R or Python, can really help your profile. So that's kind of what I would say. And obviously, you know, your coursework, so sort of knowing or having a bigger picture of the science behind all of it is obviously essential. So that would be the first question. Which institute courses, if required, to focus on for this specific field? Again, cell and molecular biology would be the most important course, I would say. And I'm specifically talking about the courses up until probably third year, because that's maybe fifth semester, because that's around the time that you apply. So, you know, just be really focused on cell and molecular biology course, because it comes in handy at, you know, various instances, and it has always been very useful for me. Apart from that, bioinformatics is one course that's offered really late, but it would be great if you could sort of figure out basics of it or take an online course to sort of brush up the basics, because that also comes in very handy. And you know, just take some extra courses in analyzing sequencing data, which I'm doing now. But it would be very useful, because going on, it could be useful in so many different fields that you wish to be a part of. That would be it. So there's another question which says, can we get a good placement and internship by focusing only on coursework? I don't think so. I personally think that it's specifically in my department, or our department, I don't think that it works out that way. You need to have good research experience, you should have worked in a lab or been part of a couple of projects, because obviously it gives you research experience, and then almost always you would have to have some sort of recommendation letter, and definitely if you want to be part of one of the good labs, they would ask for a recommendation from the professor you've worked with or without a program. So you know, that would be very helpful if you could actually work with people. And I don't know of cases where you can just do it with coursework. So I think coursework is important, because it gives you sort of a broader perspective, but you know, you would have to do some projects or like things like that to actually land on something good. Is it necessary to convert to MTech to get a core job? I don't really know much about core jobs. I think there are some really good startups coming up now, so you know, it's definitely worth looking into it, and I think you can get them without an MTech, and so just a BTech would do. An MTech, I mean, I've converted to MTech because obviously I had dropped the semester, and so there were compulsory courses that I had to do back from that time, and also, you know, I wanted to sort of do explore something else and sort of make a concrete plan for myself. So I think MTech is good that way. But if you're looking for a very like specific BSB core job, I don't think that there's much that can work out in your favor with just a bachelor's or even a master's degree, because most of the jobs where you actually have to think or like the good work are based on or are actually offered to people with sort of graduate degrees or, you know, PhDs and stuff like that. So that's something that I don't really know of that well, but if I had to answer, I don't think so. How to get a research intern at good universities, that's something I've explained. And again, I would, you know, attach the mail template that I've used, and you know, to anyone of you who wish to apply to Khurana or any of these programs and have to write an SOP for the same, feel free to reach out, because I can share my own SOP and that might help some of you. Again, the second question is, the next question is, can we, Okay, I've answered a lot of these. There's one more. I want to pursue my PhD in genetics and neural engineering in foreign universities like Stanford or Harvard. What are the factors that help increase our acceptance into those universities? And what are the key factors for getting a foreign research internship? So I haven't applied for PhD yet, but from all that I've tried to know and the research I've done, what matters the most is obviously, you know, your research profile in general, but I guess you'd need to have some really strong recommendation letters. It not only speaks for the stuff that you've written in your SOP or, you know, the projects you've described, it just sort of validates them in some way, and it's one of those things that people look for first in your profile. That's, I think, how I got Khurana scholarship as well, and that's how I think it would be very important going forward to get a PhD. So just make sure you have really good recommendation letters. So work really hard for them. And secondly, just have a good CPI. I think one of the other reasons for converting to MTech is that I would have an MTech CPI, which could be slightly better than my UG CPI. So, you know, just maintain a good CPI, and again, you know, you just have to do the other stuff, just prepare for GRE and, you know, the basics. So yeah, I think that would be the most important thing. Again, you know, the whole trick is just have research experience and people who can vouch for that. And rest almost always falls in place. And again, I've described the key factors for getting a foreign research internship, but one thing I would like to add is that make sure that you tap into all of these like people that your professor is in touch with or has worked with, because I think a lot of us, I've tried that back when I didn't know I would get Khurana scholarship, is that talk to professors you've been working with, and I'm sure that, you know, there will be people that they know that could be good fit for you, and, you know, they might give you a personal recommendation and might write for you, and that could really help that could really increase your chances of getting into those places. So yeah, that would be my personal take on it. But I'm yet to experience what how the applications go and how people are accepted. So, you know, I could talk more about that post applying. And I think that would be almost all the questions that have been asked. I wouldn't know a lot about, you know, profiling companies and all that, because I'm not. I've never really tried for job stuff, but I just know that there have been a lot of startups up and coming, and more so probably now in the COVID era, that you can look forward to and maybe try to be a part of. So I think that's almost all the stuff that I wanted to talk about, I guess. Yeah, so yeah, just, and again, for SOP, make sure that you have a story that's powerful as to why you want to be in the field that you want to be. And, you know, I just hope it works out for all of you. And I'm sure it'll get better with time, the whole situation. And I wish you all the very best for everything that's coming ahead of you. And thank you for